Let us pray. Creator God, on this great day of celebration and achievement, we give thanks for the privilege of study and research, for the wisdom of those who encourage us to search for the unknown without fear of the consequences, for family and friends who have supported us and encouraged us to achieve our goals, we give thanks. Bless all our graduates, those who will use their newfound wisdom to push forward the frontiers of science in seeking to address the needs of the world. Inspire those who will use their imagination and curiosity for learning to promote greater understanding of our physical world, and those who will use their skills to plan and engineer an exciting new future. Bless all our graduates as they journey forth from here to their different places and countries of work. May they meet each new opportunity with a bold and daring spirit, and may they find happiness in all that they do. Amen.
Thank you, Chaplain. Please be seated. Good afternoon to you all, and welcome to this afternoon's graduation ceremony. And it's my pleasure to start the ceremony to ask the Principal and Vice Chancellor to address the assembly.
Chancellor, Lord Provost, graduands, honorary graduand, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to start by welcoming you all to this ceremony, and to those of you who are visiting Dundee for the first time, I'd like to extend a particularly warm welcome on behalf of the City and the University of Dundee. Now, graduation is very rightly your day, but I should also say that for me, and all the people standing behind me and alongside me on this platform, it's also a very proud day for us as we join you in celebrating your achievements. And it's a time of, for me, of great optimism. Optimism for our future and for the future of the university. And that optimism was fueled yesterday by the announcement that the City of Dundee has been shortlisted for the City of Culture 2017. And so that was a great announcement that was made during the middle of our first graduation ceremony on Wednesday. Now, graduation is rightly a time for celebration, but also a time for reflection on the many opportunities and the challenges to come. So while we look back on the many achievements of our new graduates, surrounded by the tradition and history of a ceremony which has changed little since our beginnings as University College Dundee in 1883, we are also focused firmly on the future. And the same continuum of pride and achievement and ambition for the future was at the heart of our thinking as we set about building and launching a new vision for the university that will shape our thinking, actions, and development over the years to come. Our vision has firm foundations built on core values which date back to the beginnings of the university and that have guided the university's development throughout its history. And at its heart are the abilities and ambitions of our staff, our students, and our graduates, whose ranks are soon to be swelled by the 3,000 or so students who will graduate during this week. We've set ourselves a very simple goal. It is to become Scotland's leading university within 25 years. And if we achieve our goal, it follows that the University of Dundee will be celebrated internationally for the quality of our graduates and the impact of our research. In developing our vision, it was important for us to define not only what we wanted to achieve, but also to be clear about why and how we'll do it. And for this reason, at the center of our thinking is a core purpose: to transform lives. Our ambitions in this respect include transforming the lives of our students, drawn from local, national, and international backgrounds, many of whom will graduate this week. And it extends to applying the knowledge and understanding we gain through research and scholarship to tackle the global problems which universities like Dundee are uniquely able to address. So to do this, we identified three key challenges which can only be addressed through sustained excellence and by working creatively together across traditional disciplines. Our first key challenge is promoting the sustainable use of global resources. And what this means is harnessing the expertise which exists throughout the university to ensure global supplies of water, of food, and energy. And it doesn't get much more fundamental than that. Our second key challenge is shaping the future through innovative design. Because good design is central to all innovations, whether through the appeal and practical utility of objects, buildings, and landscapes, or the efficiency of processes. And we'll use our leading expertise to put design at the heart of our strategy for innovation. And our final key challenge is to improve social, cultural, and physical well-being. And we'll do this through our research and teaching in social, physical, and medical sciences, and by promoting the university's central part in the cultural development and economic regeneration of the city. So let me now turn to our goal to become Scotland's leading university. Why do we look so far ahead in setting our target, and what is its relevance to those who are graduating this week? The answer is in the scale of our ambition and what that means for you as future alumni. Now, if you look back over the last 25 years, few, if any, of us could have imagined the power of the internet, the widespread use of mobile devices, or the threats now presented to the planet by global warming. And then on a local scale, who could have envisaged the transformation of the city of Dundee, its waterfront developments, and the plans for the V&A to come to our city? And the university today is unrecognizable compared with the institution I joined nearly 24 years ago. So fast forward another 24 years, and our efforts will have transformed our reputation and our standing in a manner which will benefit not just those graduating this week, but future graduates and alumni too. As I have said already, our ambition and transformational thinking gains credibility and strength from our history. Amongst our first celebrated professors were individuals like Patrick Geddes, a botanist who became known as the father of town planning, and Darcy Thompson, a biologist who applied mathematical thinking and principles to understanding the growth and form of living organisms. These individuals were interested in some of the most important and intractable problems of the day, and they brought thinking to bear from different schools of thought to address them. We emulate their thinking in modern developments, such as the Centre for Translational and Interdisciplinary Research, the Centre for Environmental Change and Human Resilience, and in our newly launched Offshore Renewables Institute. But let me now tell you a story that vividly illustrates the richness of our history and our commitment to transforming lives. It's the inspirational story of one of our first graduates, Mary Lily Walker. And on this, the centenary of her death, I would like to take the opportunity to champion her achievements. That's an image of Mary Lily on the screen there, one of the only images that exists of her. Mary Lily was not only one of the first women in Scotland to be taught in the same classroom as men, winning prizes in botany, biology, and embryology, but she was a pioneer for social reform in Dundee and beyond. Her innovative approach to addressing the issues facing mothers and children in Dundee at the time led her to found the UK's first women's restaurant to provide sustenance for nursing mothers, to set up a women's hospital where women could be treated by female doctors, and to set up children's clinics in Dundee. And the achievement for which she is best known, the founding of the Grey Lodge settlement in Dundee, which educated social workers and offered classes and activities for children in the city, still thrives today after she willed her properties to the organisation. Mary Lily also wrote the highly influential Dundee Social Union Report of 1905, which detailed the deplorable working and living conditions in the city and highlighted its dreadful child mortality rate. It was a publication that was talked about in Parliament and which was influential in liberal social reforms of the day. Before her death, Mary Lilly went on to become one of the first women parish councillors in Dundee and was one of only two women asked to write for the British Society for the Advancement of Science handbook in 1912. Mary Lilly died in July 1913, 4 days before her 50th birthday. But in her short life, she transformed the social conditions of women in our city and beyond. Therefore, as an institution, we take inspiration from Mary Lilly's story. If each and every one of us tries to emulate her ambition, innovation, and imagination, and applies those principles to the way we teach, to our research tackling complex global problems, and to harness our efforts to transforming lives, we will become Scotland's leading university. Who knows, in even less than 25 years. And in doing so, the university will become known around the world for producing leaders and achievers in all walks of life, including many of you who are graduating today. We will be the partner of choice for some of the best institutions in the world, and people will see the University of Dundee as a major player on the world stage. Perhaps most importantly, we will have a significant impact on lives in Dundee, across the UK, and around the world, delivering tangible economic, social, and cultural benefits. So today, I want to encourage you all to take the skills, knowledge, and confidence you've gained while studying at the University of Dundee and to use them to be ambitious and transformational as you go out into the world and build your own lives and careers. I wish you all well for the future, and I hope that you will continue to take pride in the success of this university, as I will undoubtedly take pride in the achievements of each and every one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Principal, for that inspiring address. It's now my pleasure to call upon the Dean of School of Engineering, Physics and Mathematics, Professor Tim Newman, for the first time.
Chancellor, I have the honour to present for the degree of Master of Engineering with honours of the first class, Carlos Causas. Edgars Damlix. Thomas Horn. Grant McBride. Graham McDowell. James Scott, Claire Summers, Jocelyn Trotter, and with honours of the upper second class, Samuel Jupe, Ruarid MacDonald, Jamie McCabe, Laura O'Brien, Callum Roy, Joshua Upton, Cecily Vested, and Christopher Wilson. And for the degree of Master of Science, with honours of the upper second class, Daniel Abigail, Callum McCoon, and for the degree of Bachelor of Engineering, with honours of the first class, Richard Gamble, Andrew Mann, Craig Nairn, Yasir Nouri, Matthew White, and with honours of the upper second class, Eamon Alfnakti, Casper Bradshaw, Riyasat Fahim, Norman Farouk, Matthew Gaffney, Christopher Gordon, Benjamin Hogan, Alistair Messi, Gary McNichol, Jonathan Moore, Patrick Murphy, Struan Robertson, and Syed Shirazi. And for honours of the lower second class, okay. Ian Black, Martin Campbell, Edward Kent, Michael Fernie, Stephen Finney, Gianluca Fino, Jack Forster, Brian Gallagher, Connor Izzet, Sabah Kashmula, Stuart Lyon, Andrew McKinnon, Gavin McDonald, Alistair Moon, Andrew Pierce, and Tony Winnery. And for honours of the third class, Paul Colburn, Neil Forbes, Siddhant Menji, Adebanke Makinda, Jonas Kuzinas, and Michael Taylor. And for the degree of Bachelor of Engineering, Abdolhamid Arabi, Stuart Rees, and for the degree of Bachelor of Science, with honours of the first class, Laura Dunn. Adam El Kamash, Liam Isles, Darren Lester, Jason Lockerty, Holly McKay, Anna McKinnon, Jill McGowan, Adam Roberts, Greg Ryder, Ewan Sneddon, Stephen Ward, and Jonathan Waitman. And for honours of the upper second class, James Brightley. Vivian Chen. Saurav Chetri. Rebecca Cottis. Leanne Derrick. Laura Dorwood. Christopher Farquharson. William Hamilton. Christopher Jameson. John Saunders. Blair Scott. Alexander Sonona. Jordan Sorby. And Stephen Wells. And for honours of the lower second class, Matthew Donald. Sarah Garden. Anne Hegarty. Thierry MacLeod Nolan. Lauren Mellock. And Claire Mulholland. And for honours of the third class, Dawn Scott. And for the degree of Bachelor of Science, Laura Hutton. Chancellor, I have the honour to present for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, Brendan Garrity. Bjorn Gerald. Bjorn Gerald. John Jeffrey. Mohammed Sadiq. Andrew Savory. Daniela Schluter. Mark Storick. Zuzhu Su. And Jan Vorstius.
Professor Newman, thank you very much. I call upon the Deputy Principal and Dean of the College of Life Sciences, Learning and Teaching, Professor David Coates.
Chancellor, I have the honour to present to you for the degree of Bachelor of Science, with honours in the first class, Johan Andersen. Jennifer Auer. Emma Bissett. Jamie Chop. Rachel Evans. Scott Haston. Karim Hussein. Catherine McKenzie. Carla Marshall. Ross Norris. Jill Swarbrick. Cara Wise. With honours in the upper second class, Adnan Afzal. David Allsop. Deborah Armour. Anika Arshid. Lindsay Aspinall. Simon Atwood. Malika Baid. Emma Black. Connor Bowen. Hannah Bradley. Jerome Braithwaite. Kirsten Brewster. Robert Broom. Alexandra Brown. Viola Brugnatelli. Laura Cameron. Cara Campbell. Jessica Chan Hui Ying. Stefan Clarkin. Laura Crudden. Fiona Cullen. Neil Davidson. Christopher Earle. Danielle Inchcombe. Tamlin Elliott. Stuart Ferguson. Giles Flowett Hill. Lindsay Forbes. Callum Forteith. Anne Louise Gannon. Stephanie Garner. Kirsty Gibson. Adam Good. Janky Gore. Laura Graham. James Hall. Jessica Hall. Ailsa Hamilton. Adam Hain. Lucy Holcroft. Emily Homer. Emma Johnston. Bryony Johnston. Claire Kennedy Dietrich. Deborah Kennett. Stephanie Kerr. Rebecca Lawson. Wei Lee. Alistair Leach. Ching Liu. Ailey Livingston. Amanda Lopez. Cheryl McFarlane. Catherine Mackay. Matthew Mayer. Amy Maxwell. Samantha McCann. Gemma McGregor. Rachel McGuigan. Amy McMahon. Ewan Miller. Robin Miller. Thomas Moffat. Nicola Maurice. Katie Nurse Ayoita. Jessica Osborne. Rory Porteous. Christina Rafferty. Gavin Robertson. Nicola Robinson. Duncan Sanderson. Laura Sansom. Rebecca Sargent. Callum Saunders. Gillian Scott. Shireen Shabestari. Shona Shankland. Joshua Schrouder. Avril Smart. Scott Smart. Jolene Smith. Andrew Sterling. Amanda Stewart. Carolyn Story. Lisa Struthel. Jose Sunstro Jimenez. Ryan Tan. Jamie Tarleton. Anna Taylor. James Thompson. Aino Vanika. Paul Thompson. Apologies. Aino Vanika. And Anna Vanika. Sharon Versteeg. Thomas Walker. Emily Warren. Lauren Watts. Jessica Webb. Mitchell White. Craig Willis. Karen Wilson. Annie Iacomini. Vladislava Yanakieva. Maria Zuckschwert. With honours in the lower second class, Faiza Asif. Kenneth Babarinsa. Fatima Bay. Anuka Bahija. Danielle Bowers. Justin Brathwaite. Hei Chung. Ewan Clark. Matthew Cook. Julie Cox. Yeah. Peter Derry. Kukanya Dube. Adam Duncan. Fura Elahi. Neil Fox. Andrew Gardine. Ewan Greenhill. Mehmet Gündoğdu. Sarah Hardy. Andrew Holmes. Joseph Holmes. James Howland. Catherine James. Carrie Jameson. Lauren Jameson. Michael Kavanagh. Rubina Kana. Akshi Khanna. Henry Koenig. Rafael Maganga. Emma McAdam. Shona McRae. Michael Melvin. Fatima Milan. Kimberly Page. Amina Reed. Saraj Sal. Olivia Sklenar. Aileen Smith. Debbie Wallace. Vaughan Wilson. With honours in the third class, Michael Highway. Joanne Howardson. Kate Lakeland. Ross Reynolds. And with unclassified honours, Sarah Preston. For the degree of Bachelor of Science, Susie Younghusband. Amy Banks. Craig Bell. Ross Dand. Scott Devlin. Ashley Goans. Ross Hockaday. Miriam Huntley. Christopher McRandall. Colin Perry. Shona Proven. Eleanor Reed. And Chris Sloan. For the degree of Master of Science, Miriam van den Bosch. And Vanessa Young.
Thank you, Professor Coates. Now call upon Vice Principal and Head of College of Life Sciences, Professor Doreen Cantrell.
Thank you, Chancellor. I'm honoured to present to you for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, Robert Bone.
Gonatopoulos Ponatsis. Catherine Hands. Vincenzo Rao. Namrata Ritu. Rosenzweig. Mm-hmm. Lauren Sutherland. Alexander von Willemotwitz Mullendorf.
Thank you, Professor Cantrell. Principal.
Chancellor, I have the honour to invite you to confer their degrees in absence upon the candidates who have been unable to attend this ceremony.
By the authority of the Senate, I confer these degrees.
Now, I mentioned earlier in my address the successful City of Culture bid, and that bid would not have been successful, I don't think, had it not been for the very strong partnership working that exists between various sectors within the city. And of particular importance in that regard is the relationship between this university and the City of Dundee, and that's reflected in the robes that I wear, in which the fleur-de-lis is a symbol of that interaction and relationship between the city and the university. And I mention this just now because I just want to pay tribute to our Lord Provost Bob Duncan, who has been present at all four of the graduation ceremonies so far. He won't be able to be present tomorrow, so I'm giving him my thanks and the thanks of the university today, and I'd like you to thank him as well, please. Now, I have one other job to do, and that is to encourage you all in a moment to join together in a joint celebration of your achievement. And to do that, I want you to make a lot of noise. Now, three ceremonies have gone before you, and I have to say that the noise levels have increased in each and every one of them. And you've got a really, really hard act to follow from this morning's degree ceremony, which you'll probably understand when I say included the Duncan of Jordanston College of Art. They were especially noisy. In fact, they were noisy all the way through the ceremony. So that's what you've got to beat. Now, you can applaud, but that really be, you've already done that. I think you need to shout and whistle, stamp your feet, and use any other implements that can legally raise the roof. You can throw your degree certificates in the air now, but be sure you catch the one that you threw up, otherwise you might end up with the wrong degree. So, can I encourage you all, including all your friends and family here today, to celebrate your success. Well done, everybody.
Try those whistles once more. I call upon Professor Stephen Decent.
Chancellor, I have the honour to present for the Chancellor's Award for Lifetime Contribution to Teaching, Dr. Fraser Smith.
You don't get that response for nothing.
No.
And last tonight you told me you don't deserve a lifetime award.
Correct.
Because you've only given part of your life to university.
Correct.
I think if you had the whole, we might not have an award big enough to give you it.
Thank you.
But it is my utmost pleasure as Chancellor to award you the Chancellor's Award for Lifetime, recognition of lifetime teaching. And thank you from the university, and thank you from generations of graduates that you train and teach.
Thank you very, very much.
Thank you. Can I now call upon Professor Sue Black to introduce the honorary graduate?
Chancellor, I have the honor to present for the degree of Doctor of Laws, honoris causa, Val McDermott. Ladies and gentlemen, Val McDermott and I are very long-standing friends who don't naturally always agree on everything, but there is one matter upon which we are firmly united, and these are in her own words. There is nothing more exciting than having a dead body in the room. So picture the scene, if you will. Two middle-aged, respectable, rather substantial ladies sitting in a coffee shop, talking excitedly. What are they saying? Well, if you venture just a little bit closer with me, then let's hear what happens. The lady with the white hair says, "I need to kill her. There has to be a dramatic spray of blood. I want a big statement. How do I do it?" The lady with the red hair says, "Well, you need to get her heart pumping. Maybe she's been out running, blood pressure's up. You need a really sharp knife coming at her from behind, one straight, confident cut. Cross the side of the neck, not too high, not too low. You want to hit the carotid if you want maximum effect. Do it in a small white room. Then you'll get a dramatic arcing with full contrast between the red blood on the white surfaces. And we simply don't understand how we manage to clear coffee shops." It's a typical conversation with one of the UK's most successful and flamboyant crime writers. A gregarious lady who has sold over 10 million books that have been translated into 30 different languages. A woman who has more awards than she has room for on her mantelpiece, and a woman who has the kindest and the most generous of spirits, despite coming from Fife. Born and brought up in the kingdom across the Tay, Val was the first in her generation to go to university. She stated bravely, if not rather rashly, that if you were bright in Fife in the 1960s, then you went to St. Andrews or Edinburgh. But if you weren't quite so smart, you went to Dundee. It's just as well we've addressed that little imbalance, isn't it, Miss McDermott? But Val was bright, and it was noticed. She was selected to be part of an educational experiment whereby the most gifted and talented children were fast-tracked through school in preparation for early entry into university. She was accepted by St. Hilda's College and at only 17 became the youngest ever student accepted into Oxford from a Scottish state school. English was her passion, but it wasn't an easy transition for a young girl from deepest, darkest Fife to merge seamlessly into the alien world of Oxford. The Fife accent had to go if she was to have any hope of even being understood. And while she initially feared that it would be an elitist community and she would be excluded as an outsider, in fact, she found it to be an inspirational environment where only the quality of your mind and your attitude to life mattered. and she flourished. With a degree in English under her belt, she turned to journalism, mistakenly thinking that the two had something in common. And it was while she was working as a journalist in Devon in the 1970s that she attempted her first novel. Full of hate, love, and rampant angst, it was soundly rejected by every single publishing house in London. But a friend thought it could be reworked into a play, and so at the age of 23 was born Val McDermid, the playwright Frey Fife. Her short life as a writer of drama was confirmed when she was fired by her agent because she didn't make him enough money. Well, I bet he feels sick now. And whilst writing through the day as a journalist in Devon, then Glasgow, Manchester, and finally as the Northern Bureau Chief of the Sunday People, she spent her evenings writing crime. As the Manchester Evening News crime reporter for 4 years, she saw her fair share of real-life dramas through covering the Yorkshire Ripper murders and witnessing the continuing aftermath of the Moors murders. In 1984, she started to pen her first crime novel, Report for Murder, which was finally published in 1987 by the Women's Press. And 4 years later, she took the brave step to leave journalism behind and turn to full-time crime writing, something that she has never regretted. Val's new career was to see her write over 30 novels, making her one of the most successful and respected crime writers of her generation. Her phenomenally successful Wire in the Blood series was adapted by ITV and ran for 6 series between 2002 and 2009. The debut episode recorded the highest ratings for any new drama on ITV at that time and attracted over 37 million fans who watched Robson Green play the dysfunctional psychologist Tony Hill. There was even a cameo role for Val as a journalist, but despite her one line, which she delivered with conviction, Mr. Green suggested that perhaps she should stick to what she was good at. And she is good, because amongst her long list of awards is the much coveted and prestigious Crime Writers Association Cartier Diamond Dagger Award, which she won in 2010 for her contribution to crime fiction. Val had entered the hallowed Hall of Fame for her genre. Widely hailed as one of the grittiest and most unflinching writers of our time, it is time to finally dispel that finely crafted myth that she produced herself. Because I can tell you that she was incredibly nervous about coming into my dissecting room. But when she did, I knew it would have a life-changing effect on her. She was instantly struck by the atmosphere of studious intent, respect, and enthusiasm from our students hard at work at their chosen subject. Val is a fiercely intelligent woman, and she instantly appreciated the monumental importance of the relationship and the gift that is transacted when the decision is made to bequeath your mortal remains so that others may learn. Her fear was overcome and forgotten in an instant as she demonstrated the maxim by which she lives and writes. If something discomforts you, it's better to walk towards it slowly and with purpose than it is to run away. With her newfound respect for anatomy and an understanding of the relevance of body bequeathal, it was an easy step to persuade her of the importance of the brave and bold new project at Dundee to build a very special mortuary. We got to thinking one of those days in a coffee shop that athletes like to have sports stadia named after them, and doctors like to have hospitals named after them, but who on earth would have to want a mortuary named after them? And of course, the answer was just blindingly obvious. And so we launched the uniquely successful Million for a Morgue campaign. Val persuaded 9 of her crime writing colleagues to enter into a competition to see who could help us to raise the most money. And I'm delighted to say at the moment she is still in the lead, but Tess and Stuart are hot on her heels. But I will say to you all in the room, the doors aren't closed. So if you wish to help Val secure that mortuary in her name, then we'll have the buckets ready at the garden party. This venture has seen Dundee lead the UK in the teaching, training, and research of applied anatomy. We are the only anatomy department in the country who's adopted this new form of embalming that is ideally suited for surgeons and other practitioners to learn and practice their skills and develop new approaches and technologies that will save lives. The success of this venture, ladies and gentlemen, lies firmly at the door of this wonderfully generous and charismatic woman and her determination to make a difference. She's not afraid to tackle something new. Indeed, hopefully, yep, there we go. This is her latest venture, a foray into children's literature, My Granny is a Pirate. A story written largely for her son, Cameron, but a torment for her own talent because it's politically incorrect to use words like kill or dead in a children's book. So can you imagine what it's like for a crime writer not to be able to use the two most potent words in her vocabulary? Sometimes, though, I think there is a little bit of an underhand payback in this friendship of ours. Unless I'm much mistaken, the granny and the granny pirate looks a bit like a deranged, middle-aged, curly-haired, redhead, wearing glasses, who has a penchant for bones. No, don't encourage her. Wealth and international recognition are driving forces for many, but not for Val. Her father was a passionate, down-to-earth man who was a scout for Raith Rovers Football Club, and many of her most precious memories, childhood memories, surround her father, Starks Park, and her passion, which has ultimately become her own, which is footy. So please feel sorry for me sitting at lunch today with Professor Downs on one side talking football and Val McDermott on the other talking football. So much so that she helped to fund a new stand for the club, which you can see as you pass through Kirkcaldy on the train. But you'll notice that it isn't the Val McDermott stand, just the McDermott stand. Because in Fife, it's a funny place. She isn't the hugely successful international best-selling crime writer. She's just Jim McDermott's wee girl. Ladies and gentlemen, Val McDermott is one of the most self-effacing, generous, passionate, ethical, talented, fearless, and driven women that I know. And the university and I are truly blessed to call her a friend. Chancellor, I have the honour to invite you to confer upon Val McDermott the degree of Doctor of Laws.
By the authority of the Senate, as Chancellor of the University, I confer upon you the degree of Doctor of Laws. Congratulations. Now, the lady from Fife may wish to say a few words and take revenge on her friend, maybe.
Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this honour. And it is an honour. And indeed, in recognition of the honour Dundee has paid me, I am wearing my Urwilly hairstyle today. I left my dungarees and my bucket outside, though. And I have to say, I'm incredibly impressed by the volume you produced in here this afternoon. If you should find yourselves with a spare Saturday any time, you'll always be welcome at Starks Park if you want to see proper football. I came from a very ordinary background, just across the river there in Fife, which you all know is a very ordinary place. Not. My grandfathers were both miners, my dad worked in the shipyard, but one thing that my family understood was that the way to a better life was through education. And so from the earliest age, I was encouraged to read and to learn about the world. Before I could even read myself, my mother used to take me to the library, which I couldn't actually pronounce. I used to say we were going to the Labrador. My mother thought I'd been going to the dogs ever since. But as soon as I was able to get my hands on library tickets, that became my home from home. And of course, because back in the olden days, you could take four books out at a time, but two of them had to be non-fiction, because God forbid you should just have pleasure. The advantage of having to read all this non-fiction meant that it opened a wide window on the world for me, and it filled me with ambition and it filled me with desire. Through going to the library, I discovered many things about the world. One of them was that being a writer was a job that you actually got paid money for, that the books didn't just appear on the shelves by magic. And so I decided pretty early on that was what I was going to do. I was going to be a writer. I thought, I can tell lies. I could do that. And so I formed the ambition that that was how I was going to spend the rest of my life, was telling stories and getting paid for it. And of course, for somebody like me, a wee lassie from Kirkcaldy with no track record whatsoever in anything to do with the arts, the message I got loud and clear from a lot of people was, people like us don't do things like that. People like us don't become writers. But I had the great advantage of growing up in a household where my father was a great aficionado of Robert Burns, and he understood that you should let no man be your master, that you should form a dream and you should hold on to your dream and that you should dare to dream. And so I was always encouraged at home to have dreams and not to listen to the people who said, people like us don't do things like that. And so I ended up, as Sue said, going to Oxford University in the teeth of opposition from many people around me who said, people like us don't do things like that. And it was indeed a culture shock for me going there. It wasn't just that they didn't understand a word I said when I broke into Broad Fife, which was all I knew back then. Came what I mean, eh? Everything was different. Even the vegetables were different. They would put things down in front of me at the table and I wouldn't know if it was a table decoration or the vegetables. One time we went to an Italian restaurant and I didn't recognise anything on the menu because in our house we didn't have pasta. But I thought I remembered having had a pizza once. So I ordered the pizza and this round flat thing came with like tomatoes and cheese and things on it. And I looked at this and I said to the waiter, that's not a pizza. And he said, of course it's a pizza. I said, well, it's not what we call a pizza in Fife. In Fife, a pizza's half moon-shaped and covered in batter. So as you can see, there were things I had to overcome along the way. But the one thing that's kept me going in the teeth of the difficulties, the rejections, the things, times when things did not go well, because, you know, standing here today, looking at me now, looking at the success I've had over the years, it's easy to think it's been a piece of cake and that everything has fallen into my lap. I can tell you now that it hasn't. It's been a hard fight and tough struggle a lot of the time. But the thing that has always kept me going was not listening to the voices who said, people like us don't do things like that. In my head, when somebody says, you can't do that, that's a spur that makes me go, just watch me. And I hope that for all of you sitting here today, that you will take that out into the world with you, that you too will dare to dream the big dream. Don't let people tell you what your limitations are. Go out and knock down the walls. Dare to dream. Don't listen to the naysayers. Go out, take your degrees, and make a wonderful life for yourselves, the lives that you want. Dare to dream and dare to take the dream in your hands. Thank you again.
So I can enjoy you. You might be from Fife, but you're a class act. And I have no doubt that our award-winning choir has some message for you too. Or some entertainment indeed. Often known as Simone Gabriel and the accompaniments. Fantastic. Thank you very much. I won't hold you now long from your garden party, so please be upstanding. I declare this academic ceremony closed.